Good morning, Branchline. Today, we're going to continue our study of Philippians. So if you want to open your Bible or your Bible app to Philippians chapter 1, we're going to be camped out there. Last week, we had concluded Paul's greeting sections of the letter, right? The part of the letter where he's like, hey guys, everything's kind of good here. I'm in prison, you know, all that kind of jazz. And he says his hellos and kind of his really big picture kind of stuff. And now, today, we're going to start the section of Paul's letter where he starts giving his pastoral advice. Yay, right? Just what you want someone to tell you, give their advice, right? So we're going to read our passage for this morning. It's Philippians chapter 1, verses 27 to 30. And it says this: above all, you must live as citizens of heaven, conducting yourselves in a manner worthy of the good news about Christ. Then, whether I come and see you again or only hear about you, I will know that you are standing together with one spirit and one purpose, fighting together for the faith, which is the good news. Don't be intimidated in any way by your enemies. This will be a sign to them that they are going to be destroyed, but that you are going to be saved, even by God himself. For you have been given not only the privilege of trusting in Christ, but also the privilege of suffering for him. We are in this struggle together. You have seen my struggle in the past, and you know that I am still in the midst of it. Let's pray. Father, we pray that you would open our eyes, our ears, and our hearts to your message this morning. That we would be a community of people bound together, serving one another. Father, that we would share with each other in the same way that you and the Son and the Holy Spirit share together. Father, we pray that you would put that into our hearts, a love for each other, as we are a part of your community, your kingdom. And Father, as we study what that means, we just pray that you would give us an understanding that would enliven us, spark something in us to live in a different way. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Last week, we studied that famous passage, right? To live as Christ, to die is gain. And when we studied that passage, we said Paul was actually more concerned with the Philippians to teach them that their lives matter, right? To not be in a hurry to escape off to heaven. That they each have a purpose. And to live that life, their purpose, in service to Christ and not to themselves. It was above and against the Greek saying to live is good, where they were pursuing the good life. And how to live that good life. Paul instead says, pursue Christ. To embrace the ways of Christ instead of chasing what the world says is the good life. This is how Paul ends his greetings to the Philippians and how he launches into his advice for them this week. And he starts it by saying, above all, or kind of in the Greek, it's like, always remember this one thing. He says, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the good news about Christ. This is his big idea for the next chapter and a half. This statement could encompass all of Christian behavior. For Paul, in all things, this is what he is trying to do with every action in his life. Is he living in a manner worthy of the good news of Christ? Do his actions and words spread that good news, the gospel of Jesus? Does he reflect Jesus? Is he living up to the gospel and dedicating his life to representing it well? And church, you're probably thinking, yeah, right, that's awesome. What does that look like? Right? Pretty complex idea, isn't it? And Paul kind of answers this here. But instead of going into a long list of do's or don'ts, which we think would be easier, Paul actually talks in metaphors. Three of them to be exact. And so we're going to take a look at these three metaphors today in search of understanding what does it mean to conduct ourselves in a manner worthy of the good news. But to start, I want to explain first how the Bible uses metaphors so we're all on the same page. A metaphor, church, is used to explain a complex idea with a simple image. Okay? Metaphor is a complex idea, and we use a simple image to try and explain it. gives us an image on our mind that describes something or how to understand that very complex thing. For instance, we say, I could eat a horse, right? Metaphor. We're not going to actually eat a horse, right? We're really hungry. Maybe, yeah, depending on how long the workday was, right? But we're very hungry, right? We could eat a lot. Or how about that person marches to the beat of their own drummer, right? They're just going to ruffle everyone's feathers. They're not going to do what they're told, okay? So that's the person that marches to the beat of their own drummer. Or how about this one? Parents with young children, my house is a zoo, right? It's not that we have a lot of animals in our house. It's just that my kids are terrible at listening and create so many messes I can't keep up, right? So if you ever step foot in the Langbean household, now you know why. It's not Kristen and I's fault. We blame our children, where the blame should be. Metaphors use a simple image to describe something complex. And in fact, the Bible uses metaphors all the time. Now, these are not exact representations, and they always fail at some point to paint the whole picture of what is going on, but they help us understand something quickly and easily. So some of the Bible's in the metaphor, right? The Lord is my shepherd. Okay, is the Lord an actual shepherd shepherding sheep? No, but he's like a shepherd that cares for their flock. God is creator. God is healer. God is a consuming fire. God is the mother hen protecting her chicks. God is a rock, a tower, a strong fortress. God is a potter wielding his clay. Some lesser known ones, God is a beekeeper. God is a loaf of bread. Yeah, that's in there. God is a tree. Jesus talks about God and he uses images like judge, father, landowner, gardener. Jesus is referred as the light of the world, the vine, and we are the branches, God's son, son of man, a bridegroom, all metaphors, a simple term to explain something complex. And here's the thing about metaphors. They are all true, in a way, but no one single metaphor fully explains everything. They explain a part of God or a part of how God works or does things, but we can't pick and choose our favorite metaphors and ignore the rest. For instance, I like God as shepherd. That's a good one, comforting, right? He leads us beside still waters and lets us lay down in peace and quiet, right? But God is a consuming fire. Does that one feel good? Eh, not so much, right? We want the God who takes care of us, but maybe not the God who's, you know, burning away our impurities and sin. That might be a little painful in the process, right? God is all of these metaphors and more. These metaphors explain something about God, but none of them fully describe God. And even all the metaphors together fail to fully describe God. In fact, it's so hard to describe God that when Moses encountered God as a burning bush on top of a mountain, he asked, "By what name should I call you? How can I describe you to the Israelites so that they believe you sent me?" And God doesn't say, "I'm the healer, I'm the deliverer, I'm the restorer, I'm their king." God just says, "I am who I am." Like, thanks, Popeye, right? Anyone remember the Popeye? "I am who I am." Yeah, okay, spin it. Okay. I was trying an old pop culture reference. We'll see how it goes next week, okay? Because God is so big that any single name or metaphor cannot contain this divine person. God is who he is. And so metaphors are used to give us an inkling into the complex nature of God. And thus Paul, when describing the very complex way of life that we all should live, uses three metaphors to describe it. So let's jump into these and see what it means to live a life worthy of the gospel. The first metaphor that Paul talks about is he says, we are citizens of heaven. Now, in our English translation today, we read, you must live as citizens in heaven, conducting yourselves. But in the Greek, that entire sentence is one word. And that word is politouamai. So live as citizens of heaven, conducting yourselves. That's all one Greek word. Okay? And this word means to be a citizen or live as a citizen. But it's not of Rome, it's not of Greece, it's not a citizen of Israel or even church, a citizen of America. But it's a citizen of God's kingdom. Not any earthly kingdom. Because when you're a citizen of a kingdom, you need to obey the authorities of that kingdom. And so we obey God within his kingdom. In the Old Testament, the Israelites believed this meant living according to the law of Moses in Israel. But for Paul, it means living this new way of Jesus, to follow Jesus' kingdoms, the church, all around the world, and not just in a specific location. And what does it mean to be a citizen in a kingdom? Well, the way that we typically define citizenship is to talk about your rights and privileges, and also your duties and responsibilities as a citizen. So, for instance, in America, we have a Bill of Rights. We have a Constitution. We have laws that protect us and give us certain things because we are a citizen of America. And we also have duties and responsibilities, like we pay taxes, right? And we also, as younger age people, have the potential to serve in the military through a draft, if need be. Now, as citizens of God's kingdom, we also have rights and privileges, duties and responsibilities. Some of our rights and privileges are that you are loved by God. You are in right relationship with him. You are forgiven. You are part of a new community of fellow citizens that surpasses anything in this world. We share our life and our possessions with each other, and we are given the promise of eternal life. And we are given the Holy Spirit to guide and empower us. Church, these are awesome rights and privileges being a part of Jesus' kingdom. And church, that means you need to learn to accept those rights and privileges. Some of us struggle and worry that we're not worthy of God's love. We wrestle with the idea of God forgiving us as we battle our sin. We sometimes measure God's goodness and his plan according to how well our life is going and how much difficulty we face. We shouldn't live as that way, but we should live as citizens, which means it needs to accept all the rights and privileges. But it also means we have to fulfill our duties and our responsibilities as a citizen. That we act according to Jesus' commands, that we forgive others, love even our enemies, that we will seek to share and invite others to become a citizen in this kingdom. Church, that we would share our possessions, that we would work hard to abstain from sin and chasing the pleasures of this world. Jesus commanded his disciples to live a certain way, to represent the kingdom of God as citizens on this earth. And his citizens are the ones who are to live in such a way that we invite other people to become a part of that. To live a life worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ, you must be a good citizen, accepting the good things that God has given you and also fulfilling your duties and responsibilities. But church, it's also important to remember that you don't earn those rights and privileges by doing the duties and responsibilities. Church, you don't lose citizenship if you fail in one of these. In fact, Jesus makes you a citizen by his death, his resurrection, and your faith in him. You're already a citizen through faith. Paul just wants you to act like the citizen that you already are, to live a life worthy of the good news that you already accepted. So our first metaphor, right? Be a citizen of heaven. But Paul starts a second metaphor now. And he says, whether I come and see you again or only hear about you, I know that you are standing together with one spirit and one purpose. To live a life worthy of the gospel, we are good citizens and we are soldiers standing together. Now, I know I'm not huge on the military metaphors, but I'm just relating what Paul wrote here, okay, right? Paul says that we are to be standing together with one spirit, one purpose. And the key word here is standing together. In the Greek, it's stako, which makes me hungry, right? Stako. And it means to stand firm, persevere, persist. It was a common battle term, right? For soldiers, they would stako no matter what came at them or how savage the battle was in front of them. You kind of imagine this group of soldiers who are under heavy fire and they depend on each other. And they stand their ground, and they fight back against the enemies, and they struggle not only to save their own lives, but the lives of the fellow soldiers around them. Living in a manner worthy of the gospel of Jesus means we need to be good soldiers. Because, church, there is a battle being waged between the forces of good and evil in this world. Now notice Paul here doesn't say who the enemy is. The enemy could be Satan or demons, right? This is a common enemy throughout Scripture and Jesus' ministry on earth. And so we fight back together against them. But the enemy could also be civil or government authorities like the Romans who killed Jesus, who have locked Paul up in prison and might be persecuting the church in Philippi. The enemy could be other religious leaders. For instance, when Christians went and started a new church in an area, not long after, the Jewish authorities usually came in because they felt like Christians were warping the Jewish message. And so they would preach and teach against the Christians. Or the enemy could be fellow Christians, right? The ones that Paul said earlier in his letter that they're preaching the gospel, but they're doing it for the wrong reasons. Or, as we'll find out later, it's when Christians fight against each other, even in the church in Philippi. You see, Paul doesn't say who the enemy is because it doesn't really matter who the enemy is. That's not what Paul's trying to get at. Paul knows, and Jesus has told us, there are going to be many enemies who try to attack us when we try to live in a way that is worthy of the gospel of Jesus. But Paul says, if you want to battle any of these enemies, then you need to be of one spirit and one purpose. And the Spirit here isn't talking so much about the Holy Spirit, although we do pay attention to that and live by it. But the Spirit that Paul is talking about here is like when the spirit of a people join together. Have you guys ever been a part of something like that? Where you're with a group of people and like, yeah, you might be individuals or something, but then something happens and all of a sudden you're like, we're together. We're tackling this problem. This is an us thing now. Because church, what Paul is getting at is we need to be a people whose spirit is joined together. We can't stand our ground together and fight the enemies around us if some of us want to surrender, or if some of us think, well, they're the fighter, I'm not the fighter, or if some of us think, well, we should go left, or we should go right, or we should retreat, or we should, right? We need to be of one spirit and purpose, especially when battles and wars are happening. Going back to prior to World War II, in January of 1940, Americans overwhelmingly opposed war with the Axis powers of Germany, Italy, and Japan. One Gallup poll found that in January of 1940, 88% of Americans opposed declaring war. 88% of America. That was like one purpose, one mind for America, right? To not go to war. But on December 7, 1941, when Pearl Harbor was attacked, America responded and finally had the same spirit and purpose. A poll taken that day said 97% of Americans now wanted Congress to declare war. Being of one spirit and one purpose is to have a no matter what comes our way, we're in this fight together now kind of attitude. And Paul says we need to be like those soldiers. No matter the battle going around them, they stand firm. They persevere. They persist in the face of their adversaries, whoever and whatever that may be. We're actually going to go into chapter 2 in a few months, I assume, what this looks like in further detail. And I'll give you a hint, church. It doesn't involve guns or physical violence. I'm just going to throw that out there right now. Just FYI. But the one thing that I want to say about this, how we view the enemies of our faith, whether it's Satan, demons, governments, other religions, or even fellow Christians, is that we need to have this attitude, church. Any problem that we face or an individual faces is our problem, and we solve it together. Like, look, there can't be groups of us in the church, like an attitude of us and them, and we're against each other. It can't be an us versus our problems and adversaries, and it can't be like us versus others of us, right? It is in us versus our problems. Because church, as Jesus says, a house divided against itself cannot stand. We need to stand together and not be intimidated by any of the problems or enemies we face. And instead, church, we have to have the courage to act together towards our problems and work out the details together. So if Satan attacks one of us, he attacks all of us. If our government persecutes one of us, they persecute all of us. If other religions and churches mock, ridicule, or seek to destroy us, we stand together. And if ever we start fighting against one another, church, we need to stop ourselves and remember, we stand together against these problems. We are not enemies with one another. We have so many enemies out there, let's not make any more in here. Right, church? And what we ultimately have to understand is we're not going to let our enemies pick us off one by one. We rally to each other. We make your problem and your problem our problem together. And church, that's going to require you to actually send up the red flare whenever something you're under attack for, right? It's going to require letting your fellow soldiers know you're in a battle and you need help. And church, it also means rallying around people when you see them in a fight against an adversary or enemy. Make sure none of us are battling alone. So church, we're citizens, we're soldiers, and now Paul moves on to his third metaphor, saying fighting together for the faith. Which, you know, you might think fighting together isn't that soldierly thing, but to live a life worthy of the gospel, we are actually athletes fighting together for the faith, the gospel. Paul here is getting at being in community with one another, right? Athletes have a fellowship with one another, camaraderie, mutual understanding, and they work together as a team instead of as individuals towards a common goal, the faith, the gospel. The Greek word here is synathleo, and you might notice syn, it's kind of like a meaning together or with each other, and athleo is where we get the word athlete from. It means to contend together. And it means fighting together or striving together or contending together as athletes do to a common goal. And Paul says that goal is the faith, the good news, the gospel. And it kind of reminds me of a tug of war game, right? You guys ever played in a tug of war game? Yeah, did you win? No? Yeah, we're church people. We're not like muscle-bound heroes. Well, some of you are, but I'm not. Moving on. Giant tug-of-war game, right? You're all on the same team. You're all struggling together to win the game, right? Everyone needs to pull with all their might for you to win as a team. Now, what happens to this group of, I think that's eight dudes. I don't know, they're Dutch, right? So they blend in together with the orange, right? But what happens if this team of eight dudes show up and only three start pulling on the rope while the other five kind of stand around the rope? Are they going to win? No. What happens if on game day, half of them don't even show up? Are they going to win? No. How about if half of them have been training, lifting weights, getting stronger, they've been eating right, they get enough sleep the night before, but the other half of the team parties the night before and comes hungover to the game? Never happens, right? Are they going to win? Maybe, depending on how buff those three dudes are. They are Dutch. They are Dutch. As athletes, we struggle together. We join together to either win or lose as a team. Towards that common goal, our faith, the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. And that means, are we fighting together to have the gospel transform us? Right? Do we live together in community? Are we studying Jesus's good work in us? Are we helping to transform each other? Are we spending time with other Christians in deep ways to get our minds and our bodies ready to contend together? And are we fighting to spread the gospel around us? Are we working together to be a community that shares the good news of Jesus Christ? Are we encouraging each other? Are we pushing each other to invite others? And church, when others join us, are we as a community coming around to encourage them, make sure that they know God loves them, and we're going to do our best to do the same, right? Is everyone fighting together towards these common goals for the gospel? Or are we just kind of, some of us are here because, you know, we're supposed to, because we always grew up in a church, or are some of us here because we feel bad and I should probably come to church to be absolved of my sin for this week, or, you know, whatever the motivations are. This is the goal that we contend towards. This is what Paul wants from this church in Philippi. He wants them to be all on the same page, supporting each other and working together as a team to spread the gospel. He doesn't want division to separate them. He doesn't want any of them to relax while the others do the work. He wants all of them to be a part of the team. And so, church, we kind of ask ourselves the question, do you feel like you're part of a team here at Branchline? You don't need to raise your hands for this one, but reflect on it, right? Do you feel like you're part of a team here at Branchline? I feel like we got some people, right, who we're all working together as a team to transform each other and share the gospel. And we do work together pretty well on Sunday morning, right? We have people volunteering back in our children, our tech, our worship, right, to make this thing go. We got people leading worship. We got people sharing teachings. And we got people that are willing to pray for each other. On Sunday morning, we're all working together here, right, to sort of be a vehicle of the gospel, to transform ourselves and to spread the good news of Jesus. And so that's good. I hope you feel like you're a part of the team here for Sunday morning. But what about outside Sunday morning? Do you have your small group of fellow Christians who are your team out there, that they got your back, that you're praying for them, they're praying for you, you touch base, you grab coffee together, you share life with one another? See, that's my hope for us. Not only that we would have a solid Sunday morning, but that each of us knows the game does not end there. We still have to work together as a team when we leave this place. Now, church, if you don't know who your team is outside of Sunday morning, right, if you're like, I don't know who those people are, then I want you to look around you today, and I want you to find someone, and I want you to invite them to coffee. That's how this thing kind of starts. Start a group outside of this church where you're like, I want to meet regularly with other Christians so that we can build each other up and talk about the work of the gospel in our lives and how Branchline is going to affect the gospel in Hastings. And church, if you already have a group like that, like you got your friends that you regularly meet with and you know who those people are and you're like, yeah, I got my team, then look around you and invite someone else to join your team. Grow that small group of friends into a larger team. Because we got people out here that are struggling on their own throughout the week, standing alone in a game of tug of war against life. And we need those people to find the community of people who can have their back through thick and thin, beyond just Sunday morning, getting together, singing some songs, growing in our faith, and then leaving this place. So I'm going to invite the worship team back up. We'll conclude. Citizens, I feel like, what's that movie? Crap, I forgot it. Where they say, like, citizens? Is it Starship Troopers? I'm doing my part. No. I know some of you haven't seen. Ryan's back there. Yeah! Sci-fi geeks. Citizens, soldiers, athletes. You guys are all three. I know it might not sometimes feel like the athlete part fits, but we are athletes contending together. These are just a few metaphors that describe what it means to be a part of this new community that Jesus started. And the thing about metaphors in the Bible, right, they don't paint the whole picture, but they give you an image of what this complex thing is all about. This complex idea of what does it mean to live a life worthy of the good news of Jesus Christ? Well, it means that we need to be good citizens, fulfilling our duties and responsibilities, accepting the rights and privileges that Jesus gives us. It means we need to be soldiers, defending one another, fighting our enemies together. And it means that we need to be athletes who contend together, work together as a team to have the gospel transform us and transform the world around us. Now, I think some of us would probably say, yeah, I'm a good citizen, but I'm kind of terrible at that part about being together as a team, right? And some of us are warriors, but we have trouble accepting the grace of God as a privilege of being in God's kingdom. And some of us love to meet with our teammates and live life together, but we don't always know how to respond in the face of dangerous enemies, or we don't know our duties and responsibilities that God wants us to know. Church, as we study these three metaphors, as we understand that Paul is reminding the church in Philippi of these things, we have to understand that he's reminding them because they're not great at all three of these. If they had this down pat, he wouldn't waste the ink. No, church, Paul wants us to understand and that church to understand that human beings are imperfect as they try to live out this new life. And like Paul, we got to remind ourselves of these things so that we can dedicate ourselves to do better, to live a better life, a life worthy of the good news of Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Yeah, that's my baby. That's Eli. He's praying. Father, we just thank you for all of life's blessings and all of the rights and privileges that you have given us through your Son, Jesus Christ. And Father, we pray that we would live lives worthy of that calling, not just as individuals, but as a community together. Father, I pray that you would create in us a heart to fulfill our duties and our responsibilities, a heart that accepts your love, your forgiveness, your mercy, your grace. Father, a heart that looks around at the people around us to figure out, how can I help? Who's in a battle? How can we stand together in that fight? And Father, I pray that you would give us a heart where we see the common goal that you have for us, a heart that seeks to be transformed and to help others be transformed by your good news through your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we pray that you would form us into a community of people that is worthy of the name of disciples of Jesus, worthy of the gospel. We know that that comes from you, and we earnestly seek it, and we pray that you would just provide, give us images, put it on our hearts, Father, soften us in ways that were hard to that message. And Father, as we go from this place, I pray that you would just start helping us to form connections with people who are out there fighting alone. Father, that you would help us to be a team beyond Sunday morning. Father, help us to be the church without walls, with no borders, and with love for all. And we pray these things by the power of the Holy Spirit in your Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen.